And welcome everybody here in Twitch chat and everybody on YouTube for our last part of our Call of the Mountain expansion review. We got the rest of the Targon cards that we're going to be talking about here. We're going to talk about dragons, celestial stuff, I don't know, beings, I guess, and a brand new champion as well. We got a lot of powerful stuff that we're about to talk about. This should be pretty fun. All right, let's start with the dragons first. All right, so here's just a few dragons that are new in Targon, and I guess one's in Demacia. But this, we have a Herald of the Dragons, 2 mana, 1/1. Your dragon allies cost 1 less. So a nice little card that can just be in play and help you play your dragons for less mana than what you normally would. You can tell it curves out perfectly with if you have Herald of the Dragons on turn 2. Your dragon allies will cost 1 less, so then on turn 3, you can play the White Flame Protector because it would normally cost 4, but it costs 1 less. This seems like just a good card for these dragons because we're gonna continue to talk even after this page. There's some other dragons that we will get to, a dragon champion even, that if you can have them cost less mana, that's going to be a big benefit for you. So I think that these dragon decks, if you want to play some dragons, they're definitely going to be playing 3 copies of Herald of Dragons for sure. All right, our first dragon though, you know, usually 4 mana for a 4/4 with Fury. Fury is a brand new keyword that is whenever I kill a unit, grant me +1/+1. So if your White Flame Protector gets into combat, kills a unit, survives, it will get +1/+1. It'll turn into a 5/5, and so on. But, you know, 4 mana 4/4 is a perfectly fine body. Nothing wrong with that. This is kind of like the 4 mana 4/4 sea monster, kind of. You know, like it's a perfectly fine card. It's a good blocker. It's good on curve. But maybe you don't need it. Maybe you just want to have a bunch more smaller stuff and then more bigger stuff. And maybe it just kind of gets lost in the middle. We'll see. Next dragon is a 5 mana 5/5. That has Fury, that's the Fury symbol, and it also has Spell Shield. Now, what we've learned from these units with Spell Shield is that Spell Shield does, unless we're completely wrong and this ends up not being the case, but what it looks like it's gonna be is that the units with Spell Shield, the Spell Shield does not go away at the end of turn. So it's not like Barrier, where your unit enters in with a barrier, like Lux enters in with barrier, but then the next turn Lux doesn't have barrier anymore. This should enter in with Spell Shield, and then it just keeps the Spell Shield. So if you ever want to cast a Vengeance to kill Fused Firebrand, you have to first cast another spell and target it and have that spell get negated, and then you get to cast a Vengeance to kill it. Units entering in with Spell Shield, where the Spell Shield never goes away, does make it seem like it's really, really difficult to play spells. It does kind of look like a bug, right? And not a dragon. We don't get like the full art right now with it. But yeah, 5 mana, 5/5, that's right on curve. That's right where you want. It also has the Fury so it can grow, and it has that protection as well. A good dragon. Our other dragon's going to be in Demacia, also cost 5 mana. Screeching Dragon. This one's going to be a really important card. This is going to also have Fury, be a 4/5 with Challenger. So it has Challenger, it can challenge something, kill it, and then grow with the Fury. That's a pretty awesome combination. But the fact that this is a 5 mana unit from Demacia, it's a follower, that means that Remembrance has just gotten better. Remembrance has another target that it can hit, and another really good target they can hit. So now Remembrance will have 1 out of 5 options instead of 1 out of 4. And now we'll have Screeching Dragon in here for Remembrance. Silence, how does it work with Spell Shield? The Spell Shield will basically stop the silence. So like, but then it'll get rid of the shield, right? Because you have to target it once to get rid of the shield. The shield will stop any spell targeting the thing whatsoever, but then the shield will be gone. You like the 5/4 Challenger better? 5/4 is kind of easier to kill. Like, the 4 health sometimes can be easier to kill before it actually challenges to get rid of anything. But of course, the 5-4 can give you another unit. Sometimes that's a great unit, sometimes it's a pretty poor unit. This has the Fury where it can grow. Like if you challenge something small, you keep it growing, keep it large. Yeah, it'll be situational for sure. Then you have Dragon's Clutch. 3 mana burst. You can either draw 2 different dragons. So from your deck, it's basically kind of like if you think about Lure the Depths of 3 mana, draw a sea monster and reduce the cost by 1. This would be draw 2 different dragons, which that's pretty awesome. 3 mana, draw 2. That's pretty great. And you know what they're going to be. You know they're going to be the different dragons. Or, and it even has versatility. It's like, that's not good enough. Let's let it do other things. Or just in case, maybe you have dragon allies in play and you want to give your dragon allies +1/+1. You can do that for 3 mana. That's not like a great use at 3 mana. Like you wouldn't play a card that said 3 mana, grant dragon allies +1/+1. There's a good chance you may play 3 mana, draw 2 different dragons. Especially when we talk about some more dragons here later on. But I don't think we would, like, you know, you probably wouldn't play the second part, but having the versatility of being able to choose whichever one you want, that is pretty awesome. So there are going to be some more important dragons that we will get to here in just a little bit. But first, let's go to our next part. So our next part we have a new keyword, invoke. Invoke means to pick a celestial card from among 3 to create in your hand. All right, so let's kind of take a look at that. So our first card that we have with Invoke here is the Mountain Scryer. 4 mana, 2/3. That says all of your celestial cards cost 1 less, which is cool. And if you hit the Allegiance, then you know it's an Allegiance card, the Targon Allegiance card, then you get to Invoke. Spacey Sketcher, 1 mana, 1/1, play it. You discard a card from your hand to invoke a celestial card that costs 3 or less. Lunari Priestess, 3 mana, 2/1. Then if you have Nightfall, you get to invoke. So taking a look at these, let's kind of look at these cards and kind of look at all of them together. So Priestess is a 3 mana 2/1. That's not a good body at all. Spacey Sketcher is a 1 mana 1/1. Discard a card, draw an invoke card. You know, that's definitely worse than the 1 mana 2/1. Discard, then draw. Your Mountain Scryer is a 4 mana 2/3 Allegiance invoke. So draw a card 2/3, not a good body. Your celestial cards are costing 1 less. So these celestial cards that, you know, we haven't really seen yet, but just from looking at this, the bodies that you're getting on these to invoke are way below the curve. It's worse than just draw a card, like that you would expect. Like if this was like 3 mana draw a card, Nightfall draw a card, you're expecting this to be a 2/2, maybe a 3/2, maybe even a 3/3. Heck, like that wouldn't be that crazy to have 3 mana 3/3 Nightfall draw a card. It wouldn't be that crazy. You know, definitely like 3/2, but we're at 2/1 in order to have Nightfall invoke. So this invoke's got to be pretty powerful, and I think we'll see that it will be pretty powerful. All right, we also have the Solari Priestess, which is a 3 mana 1/2 with Daybreak. Invoke a celestial card that costs either 4 or 5 or 6, so anywhere from 4 to 6 mana you get for a 3 mana 1/2. Moondreamer, a 5 mana 3/5. We're starting to get that sounds pretty playable with play invoke. You know, 3/5 for 5, that's pretty decent body, I suppose. And we also have Behold the Infinite, a 2 mana burst speed just invoke. If you think about like 2 mana burst speed draw card, there's a lot of cards that do more than that. It has some extra bonus plus draw card, but this just invokes. Okay, so basically, all of these cards can invoke, but they're not anything special. But so invoking means you're picking a celestial card from among 3. So basically, how that's going to work is you have 3 random celestial cards will pop up on the screen, and you will pick one that you want to draw. Now, some of those had some restrictions on, like, it has to be one that costs three or less. Some of them had restrictions of, like, it has to cost either four or five or six mana or so on. But these are the Celestial cards. They're for each mana cost from 0 to 10, there is going to be one spell and one unit at each mana cost from 0 to 10. And so, yeah, so drawing, like, you would rather have look at the top three cards of your deck and draw one of them. That's a lot more powerful than just simply draw one, right? Because then you get the choice, you get the selection. And so that's one thing that Invoke allows you to do, is it'll get you three of these. You'll look at them and you'll be able to choose one and put it into your hand. All right, so we'll kind of read these. So at zero mana, the spell is Moonlight. It's burst speed. Whoa. We'll kind of keep it right here. Moonlight, burst speed, reduce the cost of a card in hand by one. This actually, like, at first we just read this, zero mana, reduce the cost of something by one. That's not that great. And so we just invoked and we got that. But as we'll see with our next page, the new champion that's going to be a dragon, it looks really powerful and it's really expensive. And so things that can reduce its cost by one look to be quite good. So that Moonlight's going to actually probably play a bigger role than expected. Plus, you can hold, like, these aren't ephemeral cards, so you can hold on to this Moonlight, and even if you don't have, like, anything you want to reduce yet, you can kind of hold on to it, and then maybe you make two of them, and then, like, turn eight, you take a 10-mana card, and you just reduce it by one twice with these bursts, and then suddenly you're playing a 10-mana card on turn eight that your opponent is not expecting, so they didn't see that coming. Also, for zero mana, we have a 2-1 challenger. So you have Fleet Feather Tracker that you can just spend zero mana on, get yourself a Fleet Feather Tracker. Or, you know, a sapling token that's not ephemeral. Then we have Equinox, 1 mana, slow speed, silence, a follower. A lot of silence stuff in this set. So we're taking Purify, we're cutting the cost in half, but we're turning it from burst to slow. Not something you need all the time, but again, it's a nice little toolbox. Maybe your opponent has a follower that has been buffed up a whole lot, and you play your invoke thing, and you just find this Equinox, and you're like, oh, hey, this is exactly what I needed. That's why it's good to have the selection of three, because maybe a lot of times you're not choosing that one. But sometimes when you really need it, you need it. Then we also have... we also have the Charger... 1 mana, 4-1 Overwhelm. I mean, that's just awesome card. Like, sometimes you just want a 4-1 Overwhelm for 1 mana, I suppose. And you can grab that. All right, at 2 mana, we got Moonglow. Slow speed. Grant an ally plus 0, plus 2. Permanent buff. And Spell Shield. Pretty awesome. Great with champions, right? You get to put a Spell Shield on one of your champions and also buff its toughness up 2. And its health up 2. That's pretty awesome. So Moonglow, pretty good there. The 2 mana unit is going to be the Messenger. When I'm summoned, draw a card. Just a 2 mana 2/2, play it, draw a card. Pretty awesome. You know, it's like an Avrosen Sentry that has a second health that you don't need it to die. You get to draw the card right away. That's a great 2 mana one. Over at 3 mana, we have Crescent Strike, which is just 3 mana, slow speed, stun 2 enemies. Not amazing, but again, you get choices. Maybe you need that. Then we also have the Joker. You're like, or maybe like taking that will be able to stun 2 blockers and you get an alpha attack for the win. The Joker, 3 mana, 3/3 with evasion. Yeah, isn't that elusive? But yeah, but I mean, that's... Yeah, I think that should be elusive. That's elusive in for English. But yeah, 3 mana, 3/3 elusive. Great body. yeah, another good unit there. All four of these units have looked really strong so far. Written in Stars is the 4 mana spell. It's 4 mana, burst speed, draw a champion, reduce its cost by 1, and also grant it +2/+2. pretty great. So you have Entreat is 2-mana draw a champion, so you're spending 2 extra mana, but then you also reduce the cost of the champion by 1, so it's really like you're spending one extra mana, because you're going to be able to convert 1 spell mana with Written in the Stars into 1 unit mana with the champion. And why not? Let's make it larger. Let's give it +2/+2. Could work really well with a certain dragon champion we're about to go over, especially the reduction in cost, but could work well just with any champion. Like, even just think of this with, like, Twisted Fate. Making Twisted Fate cost 3 and be a 4/4, so it makes it a lot more difficult to kill Twisted Fate. Pretty awesome. And you can probably just say that with every single champion, giving it +2/+2 permanently. Yeah, Braum, absolutely. Definitely. Like Trundle, your champions with regenerate, Trundle, Garen, making any of those champions with regenerate bigger, your Sejuani giving that +2/+2. I mean, this is just going to be awesome with everything, with every champion. Oh yeah, how about Teemo? Why not? Yeah, make Teemo a 4/4, because you're going to have your leveled up Teemo, and so now your leveled up Teemo is going to be a 4/4, and it's going to cost 0. Sweet. Ooh, Fiora, Zed, Vi. Oh yeah, I mean, just Swain. Yeah, your champion's getting that +2/+2. Thresh is going to be like a 5/10 challenger or whatever, 5/8 challenger. Seems pretty awesome. Yeah, Zed now 2-mana Zed, that's a 5/4. All right, then you have the Traveler, so you can invoke, grab the Traveler, play it. It's a 4-mana 3/4, and you play it, and you get to invoke again. Pretty awesome. Just get a nice little body, and it's nothing special. 3-mana 3/4 is where you're really looking at. So 4-mana 3/4 is a little below the curve, but you get to invoke again. Yeah, 4-mana 5/8 challenger for Thresh. All right, then we have Meteor Shower, our 5-mana spell. Deal 4 to an enemy and 1 to another. I wish this said and 1 to another enemy, by the way. Like, that language. I wish it just said deal 4 to an enemy and 1 to another enemy. Or deal 4 to one enemy and 1 to another enemy. But anyway, so you get to choose 2 different enemies. It's like Static Shock. That does 1 to 2 different enemies, but it's slow speed, and one of those you're actually dealing 4 with. You Ravenous Flock 1 and deal 1 to another. Yeah. Then you have the Warrior, 5-mana 5/5 challenger. That seems like a regular Demacia card. That's very similar to the 5/4 challenger that Silverwing Vanguard, is that right? The 5/4 challenger that then gets you a new elite in hand, or even that dragon's the 4/5 dragon. So nothing too special about this, but it's a good 5-mana card. Sometimes you just want a 5/5 challenger for sure. All right, 6-mana spell is Comets. Obliterate an enemy. 6-mana, slow speed. Better than Vengeance, it obliterates any enemy, even champions. We'll see if Comets is like the real name for it. Still translating. Some of these are, we're translating them, but pretty awesome there. Yeah, the Warrior has art. Yeah, awesome art there for sure. All right, so 6-mana. So this is why it kind of looks like this. Because the 6-mana unit is actually 2 units. So you get the Golden Sister, which you play it is the 6-mana 4/3 lifesteal. That whenever you summon it, then you summon Silver Sister, which is going to be the 4/3 elusive. So 6-mana, this is pretty awesome. You get a 4/3 lifesteal and a 4/3 elusive, both of those in play. And it is a summon ability. So you can, if you do your things like your Chronicler of Ruin, a Golden Sister, you get another Silver Sister. Pretty awesome getting 2 really good sized bodies, one with Lifesteal, one with Elusive. So the 6-mana Celestial seems pretty sweet. All right, and then over at 7 mana, we get Cosmic Inspiration. If you behold a celestial card, so remember, behold means that they basically behold means you can see one. So if there's another celestial card in play for you or another one in your hand, either way, if you behold a celestial card, give all of your allies everywhere +2/+2 and restore your spell mana. So it's like playing Iceborne Legacy on every single one of your allies everywhere. They just all have +2/+2, and then plus you get to refill your spell mana. So it's like this only costs 4 because you get to get 3 spell mana back. Crazy. That thing is awesome. All right, then at 7 mana, you get for the unit, we get the Destroyer. So it's a 7 mana 7/7 that has Overwhelm and also has Spell Shield. When I'm summoned, grant me +1/+0 for each celestial card you have played this game. So if you've played 3 celestial cards this game, it is now a 10/7 Overwhelm that also has Spell Shield. You can't even, like, kill it with a spell. Dude, the spell shield on these seems like it may just be completely crazy. I don't know. I don't know if that's just me, but how spell shield doesn't just go away at the end of turn, and like you have to use a spell first on the destroyer, and then you can use a vengeance or whatever. I don't know. I'm kind of worried about spell shield on these things. It seems ridiculous. I don't know. All this stuff kind of seems ridiculous. All right, then we have our 8 mana spell. This is a celestial. Is Tomb of the Universe. So 8 mana, slow speed. That's these. So it's another slow speed spell. It does seem like everything is either slow or burst, isn't it? Yeah, everything is just slow or burst. They just don't have anything that's fast speed. Alright, if you behold another celestial card, obliterate all units with 3 or less power. That could be useful for you, maybe not. This Tomb of the Universe for 8 mana, I don't know, just a... This may not actually be that great, to be honest. But, you know, it does what it says it does. Obliterates all units with 3 or less power. That includes champions. But, you know, it's only things with 3 or less power. There's only one fast card in the whole set. Unspeakable Horror. That's crazy. All right, then we have the Immortal Fire, 8 mana celestial. This is a 6/5 with elusive. When I'm summoned, grant me +1/+0 for each celestial card you have played this game. The first time I would die, fully heal me instead. Dang. All right, so let's say you've played 3 celestials again. So now you have a 9/5 elusive. That's attacking for like half of your life, basically, and it's elusive. And if you would kill it, if it would die, instead you just heal it. Seems insane. It's elusive. How are we dealing with this stuff? All right, 9 mana spell. We're just getting crazier. 9 mana spell is Supernova. If you behold a celestial card, obliterate 2 enemies. You just get to choose 2 enemies and obliterate them. Talk about how like comments looked sweet of being able to obliterate an enemy. Now you just get to choose any 2 enemies you want and obliterate them both with your supernova, with your 9 mana spell. So it's like, you know, 9 mana is ruination. Instead of destroying everything, you get to obliterate, which is better than destroy. And you get to choose the 2 enemies you want to obliterate. We need to create an aggro deck here so we don't get Celestialed. Yeah, this definitely seems like the top end to the top end to own all top ends. Yeah, this seems like these things, they seem like, for those of y'all come from Magic, it seems like the Eldrazi in Magic. They're just silly power level. Alright, our 9 mana unit is the Great Beyond. It is an 8/8. It also has elusive, and it has Fury, and it has Spell Shield. So you can't kill it, and it's elusive. And if it kills stuff, it just grows. When I'm summoned, grant me +1/+0 for each celestial card you've played this game. And it's just also a dragon. So any like the cool the dragon things, like we just had the previous turn, we talked about the dragon, or the previous slide. We talked about like the dragon, the 2-mana 1/1 that reduces the cost of your dragons. That would be important here for the Great Beyond. So if you've played, you know, three other Celestials, this is just an 11/8 elusive with Spell Shield. What? I am a dragon. All right, Living Legends. 10 mana burst. This is burst. Can't deny this. It is burst. 10 mana, fill your hand with random fleeting celestial cards. Fill your mana. Fill your mana. So you just get all of your mana and your whole hand is just random these celestial cards. Jeez. You just get like 13 mana. Dang. If you have that Targon Allegiance card where your Celestials cost one less also. Yeah, probably fill, I don't know. Does it fill just spell mana? Does it fill all of your mana? Does it fill like 13 mana? Or does it fill just your regular mana, so 10, or maybe just your spell mana, so 3? Filling just your... filling your hand with a bunch of cards, then only filling your spell mana doesn't seem as... good. And yes, and the new Dragon Champion that I have talked about a little bit may make this card even better, and we'll talk about that here in just a little bit with the next slide, but... remember this card. This card could get really crazy. So fill your hand with random fleeting celestial cards. And these celestial cards, not bad, as we've been talking about. All right, and then finally we have the Scourge. 10 mana, 10/10, Challenger. When I'm summoned, grant me +1/+0 for each celestial card you've played this game. Again, attack, give other allies +2/+2, and overwhelm this round. So the Scourge is a huge challenger, but does not have elusive, does not have overwhelm itself. So it's, you know, it's just going to be a huge thing that kills stuff, but it does give all of your other units +2/+2 and overwhelm whenever it's attacking. So it's like a big Cythria or whatever. Yeah, these seem pretty crazy. So yeah, these are better than just drawing normal cards in your deck. So that's why. This is why how good these celestial cards are. This is why you're spending 3 mana for a 2/1 that Nightfall invokes, or your 4 mana 2/3 Allegiance invokes. This Spacey Sketcher seems awesome, but it only invokes the celestial cards that cost 3 or less. They're not as powerful. The Solari Priestess seems pretty great. Invoke a celestial card 4, 5, or 6 with the Daybreak. A 1/2 is kind of nothing, especially for 3 mana. That's a terrible body. But you're always getting a celestial card that costs 4, 5, or 6. And so as we see, like the 4, 5, and 6 ones are pretty strong. Written in Stars, the Traveler playing Invoking, and then the 6 mana with the Golden Sister, Silver Sister, pretty awesome, or obliterate an enemy. Meteor Shower is not the best. The Warrior is pretty good. But I mean, so a 3 mana 1/2 that's drawing one of these spells, pretty awesome to make sure that you're drawing one of those. And remember, you get to invokes, they'll have 3 of those come up on you know, on the screen, and you choose one of, you choose, you know, like, so they'll have a random out of these 6 total, they'll have 3 of the 6 come up and you get to choose one. So you're gonna frequently get Golden Sister, or frequently get the Traveler, or whatever you want, this Comet card, and so on. And then same thing with this Spacey Sketcher, invoke a celestial card that costs 3 or less. There are 8 total it costs 3 or less because of the zeros. So, you know, you'll get a choice. You'll have 3 of these 8 will pop up, and you'll get a choice of one of those. Um, And yeah, like this Behold the Infinite seems awesome. Of 2 mana, burst, draw one of the, you know, invoke one of these. Like that, this seems really, really good for two spell mana to be able to turn 2 spell mana into one of those cards. And then even just this Moondreamer, a 3/5 invoke, that definitely seems pretty good body because invoking is so powerful. All right, so invoking seems pretty powerful, right? Well, it gets better. It gets even better. We have the last champion in Call of the Mountain. The last champion, Aurelion Soul. 10 mana dragon. It's a 10-10. So we want to reduce the cost of dragons with the 2 mana 1-1. Also those cards that we talked about, those celestial cards that could reduce the cost, we could use that to help reduce the cost of Aurelion Soul. But it is a 10-10, and it has spell shield, so you can never kill it. And it has, and by you can never kill it, I mean you have to spend a whole lot of resources to kill it. And it has fury, so if it kills stuff, it grows. Whenever you play Aurelion Soul, you get to invoke a celestial card that costs 7 or more. And we saw those cards, whenever those ones that cost 7 or more are just really busted. So you just get to draw one of those 7 or more celestial cards that are busted. And then, round start, just create a random celestial card in hand. The beginning of your round. So you're not only you play it, you get a celestial card, then you pass turn, the next turn, round start, get another celestial card in hand, and every round you get to get random celestial cards. That's incredible. Now the level up is round end, your allies have 20 plus total power. I don't know how we haven't really won the game yet, but if it does level up, like maybe you play this on your opponent's attack turn, and you don't have the attack token, you already had 10 other power in play, you play this, now you have 20 plus total power, the round ends, you level up Aurelion Soul. And now it's at 11-11, still has that play, still has that round start, but when you have leveled up Aurelion Soul, this last line, all of your celestial cards cost 0 mana. Are you kidding me? So like, you're getting an amazing celestial card that costs 7 or more, you're still creating random celestial cards, and they all cost 0 mana. So, if you compare this, if you get the one that costs 7 or more, if you get Living Legends, it costs 0 mana, fill your hand with random fleeting celestial cards, they all cost 0 mana. Game's over. The game is over. Yeah, the round start, you get random ones. But whenever you play it, you get one that costs 7 or more. And you get to kind of choose. Yeah, very high rolly deck. But that's the only one that's random. Remember, each time you invoke, it's not just you get a random one. You get to look at three. And each time you invoke, you get to look at three and you choose which one of the three that you want. So you don't always just get terrible cards, which, you know, they're not really terrible, but you are looking at three and then choosing one. Okay. Aurelion Soul's champion spell is the Skies Descend. It costs 15 mana and it's slow speed. You may have figured out it's not possible to spend 15 mana because you can only have a maximum of 13 mana. But this one does cost 2 less for each dragon or celestial ally that you have in play. So if you got dragons or celestial allies, each one of those would make it cost 2 less. So let's say you have 3 total dragons and celestial allies. Now you're reducing the cost by 6, and so now this is a 9 mana spell. And what it does, deal 15 damage to all enemies. Oh, that's cool. Just not you, just the enemies do 15 damage to all of them. It seems like the skies are descending. Yep. Hopefully you have some spell shield on your stuff, or some barrier. Barrier would protect from that, I suppose. So yes, that's the skies descend. Alright, another burst spell. 5 mana, burst, invoke a celestial card that costs 7 or more, and then heal an ally or your nexus for for five. So, you know, you can get a nice 5-mana, draw a really powerful Celestial card, and then also heal for five, or heal an ally for five. You know, it's burst. You can use it. It's really expensive, but you can use this as like a protection spell on an ally that's going to die that you can heal for five. You know, heal as much as you can. And then also invoke as well. Star Shaping. So, I mean, that's... I mean, just the invoking thing is really powerful. I don't know if we're probably not really playing Star Shaping too much. I don't know. Maybe you are. Invoking is just so powerful. So maybe this does just go in the deck, but, you know, you want to... Against an aggro deck, you can heal for five to try to stay alive, kind of thing. All right, this card looks really cool. I like this card a lot. 1-mana, Messenger's Sigil. Burst, shuffle 5 the Messengers into your deck. So the Messenger, you may remember, that's the 2-mana Celestial card. That's a 2-mana 2-2 when you summon it, draw a card. So just a good quality 2-drop, right? 2-mana 2-2 draw a card. So this is like counterfeit copies, but your counterfeit copies is all putting the Messengers into your deck. Seems pretty cool. I like this Messenger's Sigil. And look at the pup on the picture too. So you get a bunch of Messengers that are saying, watch out, Aurelion Sword is coming. Yeah, that's a good point. You could play, like, these kind of cards work great with Lux, right? Star Shaping and Messenger Sigil. You can kind of compare these together to do... combine these together for your 6 spell mana. Burst speed for your Lux deck. But having a bunch of Messengers should slow the opponent down, where you're spending 2 mana to make a 2-2, draw a card again. That'll definitely slow the opponents down each time you draw a Messenger. It's a good way to use 2 mana. Yeah, Lux plus Celestials. The thing that a lot of people are saying, like a way to cheat Aurelion Soul into play, is the is Thresh, right? If you get a leveled up Thresh, attack with Thresh, now Aurelion Soul comes into play. Now you don't get the play ability, of course, but you do get the round start still. So that seems awesome. There is also the Freljord card that at the time, whenever we went over it, Aurelion Soul wasn't previewed yet. There's that Freljord card that costs 7 mana that that heals your Nexus. You reveal a unit in hand, heal your Nexus equal to its power, so you can heal your Nexus for 10, and also if you're Enlightened, you reduce its cost to 0. You do have to be Enlightened by that point, but you can spend 7 spell mana, gain 10 life, and then play Aurelion Soul for 0, and you know, you just spent 7 spell mana basically to play your Aurelion Soul. And it is playing, so you get to invoke, you know, you get the whole invoke thing also. Revitalizing Roar. This could be an actual reason to play Revitalizing Roar. What else we got? We got two more cool looking dragons. The art on these two cards are awesome. The art on just all the Celestial stuff, this is pretty crazy. I didn't realize Targon was going to be so crazy. We have 8-mana 8/8 for the Infinite Mind Splitter. That's such an epic name. That's so metal. The Infinite Mind Splitter. That is so metal. Alright, you got an 8/8 with Fury. So whenever it kills something, it grows. And has a play ability, you pick 2 enemies, and every round start you stun those 2 enemies. So it's build your own Swain plus Leviathan. Basically. Just keep stunning those 2 enemies every round start. And our last dragon, 6-mana, 5/6 Involius? Inviolus. Inviolus Vox. Inviolus Vox. I don't know. Anyway, it's a 5/6 with Fury. Whenever an ally with Fury kills an enemy for the first time, each round, create a random dragon in hand. So, with all these dragons having Fury, if any of these dragons kill an enemy and you have Inviolus Voxum in play, then you get to create a random dragon in hand as well. Pretty cool little card. These are definitely epic. Yeah. Not bad, not bad. All right, so that's Aurelion Soul. Looks crazy powerful. We'll have to see if the game slowed down enough. Like, are we able to actually cast Aurelion Soul consistently? It does cost 10 mana. Do we have enough things to reduce its cost and everything? You know, like, are we going to be playing... Are we going Targon plus Demacia? Where you have the Demacia dragon is the 5-mana dragon, right? And so, like, in it, it's the 5-mana dragon with Challenger. So, for your Inviolus Vox. And then the other thing about Demacia is it does have... it does have, like, single combat, another way to easily kill enemies to create more dragons. But then it also has Mobilize. Do we want to play Mobilize? Like, reduce all the cost of all your units in hand by one? Are we going to play Mobilize Aurelion Soul? Maybe. Who knows? That could be a thing. Maybe Mobilize. So maybe Demacia with Aurelion Soul. We already talked about, like, maybe Thresh with Aurelion Soul. Maybe going Freljord, going Trundle. Freljord, you got a bunch of ramp in Freljord. We talked about we saw all that ramp stuff. And then, you know, you have these expensive stuff for the beholding of your 8 plus cost spells. So, Freljord gives you early defense with Avalanche as well. And good blockers, a lot of Nexus healing. Y'all want Spectral Matron? I don't think Spectral Matron doesn't really work that well with Aurelion Soul. Spectral Matron with the 6-mana unit? Oh, just the 6-mana Celestial thing? That would be really hard to set up. Yeah, that'd be super hard to set up. I don't think we'd be able to do that. So we'll see. So that we're going to be having these new cards on Wednesday. So that's only 2 days away. Those of y'all watching this later, that's only like a day away. We're going to have all these new cards and stuff. It's going to be awesome. Those of y'all watching on YouTube, leave those comments. What kind of decks do you want to see me build? What are you really excited about with the set? All that kind of stuff. Like, what should we be playing all week? You know, feel free to give me all those champion combination ideas, and I'll be building new stuff. We're going to be playing, four new decks every day, all week, for a long time. That's what we're going to be doing. We got a new set, new cards. Targon looks incredible, and all 7 of these champions look really good and look like they'll be fun to play. All right, so that's it here for Targon, and that's it here for expansion review. We did not get to review every single card because for some reason they're just waiting waiting until the last second to give us every single card. So this isn't every single card in the expansion. There's 89 total. There's still a few that we don't know about, but that's just how it goes. All right, but anyway, that's it here for our expansion review, Call of the Mountain. Can't wait to play it on Wednesday. Thanks everybody for watching, and I'll see you for the next video.